When former 80s pop icon Pete Burns appeared on Celebrity Big Brother, he shocked the nation.
He was virgin territory to me. He was one of the most extraordinary human beings I've ever met.
His outrageous image and acid tongue divided viewers and fellow housemates alike.
He's more outrageous than anybody. He's got the most wicked gob in the world.
I wouldn't piss on her if she burst into flames.
But his dissatisfaction with his looks led him to an obsession with plastic surgery.
Makeup washes off, so why not have something that doesn't wash off?
Which saw him change his face beyond recognition over the next 20 years. This obsession led to disaster when an operation to increase the size of his lips went horribly wrong.
He held me down on a table, he pierced it, and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis, and it just went from bad to worse.
But behind the outrageous looks and the caustic wit is a very different Pete, whose turbulent past has made him the man he is today.
I didn't really have a childhood.
His mother suffered from depression, drug and alcohol dependency throughout his childhood, and attempted suicide several times, often when the young Pete was home alone.
I heard some sound that was just wrong. I pushed everything away from the door upstairs, and she'd sliced her wrists open and the veins were hanging out.
Over two extraordinary days, I was able to give Pete a psychic reading. It was a revelation to both him and me. Finally, I begin to understand what has made this man into the person we know today. I got to be your friend now, baby. And I would like to move in just a little bit closer. Pete Burns is one of the most controversial characters in British music, but I believe he has a strong spiritual side to his personality. I went to meet him at his London home to see what I could pick up from the atmosphere around him. Pete, I absolutely love your home and also the sense of peace that you feel in it here.
It's kind of fancy, isn't it?
It's fantastic. It really reflects you, I think.
I think we're like Russian dolls in a lot of ways. We have a lot of layers, and I was very aware of that from an early age. What you see on the outside is certainly not what is on the inside.
That's what I feel. Just sitting with you, I can almost feel the different layers of your life and around you, and even in the spirit world, I feel different people around you at different times of your life.
I wish they'd make themselves visible.
The feeling I get from this place tells me that your mother is actually very much around you just now, and especially currently. I feel as though she's been trying to give you signs and information in current times.
I'm very aware of her presence right now. I'm not like Norman Bates in Psycho, who I've idolized as my mother, because as far as parental skills go in the conventional world, she certainly wasn't a mother. And she's the best human being that I've ever had the privilege of being in the company of. And I know that she had a special plan for me. She's called me Star Baby.
Yeah.
And she knew that there was something special in me. Just an incredible German woman, tiny, 5 foot wob, but she could move a wardrobe. She could lift a wardrobe. Mm-hmm. I grew up until I was 5 speaking German and a bit of French. There was no English spoken in my house. My father spoke to my mother in French. She spoke to me in German.
Pete's mother, Eva, was the daughter of a German-Jewish film director, Hugh Quitner, and his wife, Maria. She attended silent film school and planned to follow her family into the film business. But the Second World War was to set the beautiful young Eva on a very different path.
She had an incredible cultural background, and she decided I was not going to have formal education, because what good would the Battle of Hastings do me in life? And she encouraged me to create and create and create, and there were no boundaries, and there was no male or female. She was right into there's no gender, and a skirt doesn't make a man. And all of these things. So I grew up in a completely open and free environment, which a lot of people think causes problems in life. Well, guess what? It did. But those problems make you stronger.
But I'll tell you what, I don't think your mother's ever far away from you.
I wish she'd make herself known.
Yeah. Oh, she does. She absolutely does. Do you know the lovely thing, and I hope you will know this,
I've just seen this most beautiful, beautiful picture of a place that looks like, it looks like something out of Hansel and Gretel.
That'll be Salzburg, where she fled to in the war,
do you know,
maybe.
What? It actually feels like something like that, almost, but there's such a lot of mountains in the backdrop.
Salzburg, yeah, where her sister lived. I've seen it already, I've been there.
Have you?
Yeah.
Because that just came into my mind, even as you were talking about your mother, and just this feeling of the amount of, if you like, Germanic connections.
When war broke out, Eva's Jewish father was forced into hiding, but was betrayed by the family chauffeur and died later in a Nazi concentration camp. Eva then went on the run with her mother and eventually met Pete's father, a British soldier, at a soldier's tea dance in Vienna.
She denied she was German. I found that on her passport. She claimed to be Austrian because she was so ashamed of what the Germans had done in the Nazi occupation. She was a German Jew, and I didn't know that until many years later, until I found her passport where she was born, because she said she was born in Salzburg. And she wasn't actually. She was born in Heidelberg, and then she lived in Berlin.
But I actually feel as though a lot of your mother is in you, that somebody like that who's so close to you can't actually die. They dissolve into your heart.
I appreciate that.
But I would assume that you're, even as I look at you and as a medium, I actually almost see your face changing into your mother. And I've never seen a picture of your mother.
That's a bit spooky. No, I've always had an incredible resemblance to her. My eyes are the same physically. I'm built the same. And I never said to a surgeon, make me look like mommy.
So how did the whole cosmetic surgery thing start?
Well, I think from a very early age, I just kind of was very intrigued in that kind of, I thought makeup washes off, so why not have something that doesn't wash off? Yeah. And I didn't know much. It was a long journey.
Pete started having cosmetic surgery in 1985, when his desire for the perfect lips led to a disastrous choice. A permanent solution was injected into his lips to increase their size. It was a chemical to which his body reacted badly. It poisoned his bloodstream, and what followed nearly cost him his life.
One day I did a show with the Scissor Sisters, and I was in pain, quite bad actually, but I didn't say anything. And after the gig, I woke up and my lower lip was, I mean, honestly, it's not a sort of, to say it was that big, that bit. And I called him, and he came back from Birmingham, and he saw me, and he held me down on a table, he pierced it, and cups of yellow fluid came out. But he didn't give me a diagnosis, and it just went from bad to worse, and eventually holes were appearing in the face, and I'd touch my face and it would hiss, and yellow stuff would ejaculate from the face. Yeah. But I mean, this is not ill. I'd leave it on the mirror because no one could believe it was coming out of my face, and I was searching for doctors for an answer. And quite by chance, I told my webmaster, Rose Keefe, why I'd disappeared, and she said, but there's a plastic surgeon on the Right Stuff website, which is my website. Yeah. And she contacted him. His name was Paolo, and he worked for an eminent surgeon in Genoa, Italy, who's a cancer reconstructive surgeon. And he spoke no English. And this wonderful woman called Marina, who's a professor of the English school in Genoa, she didn't know me, and she flew over with him to translate. And she said, you're coming to Italy, you're coming to my house, this is what he's going to do. And I went to Italy thinking I'd get four operations, but when he opened me up, he found the stuff had migrated all over the face and neck area. And he thought four operations, and it ended up like I was there 18 months, and it's ongoing for life, really.
In part two, Pete tells me about his 2 years of painful reconstructive surgery.
Two major surgeries a week to save my life, not just my face.
And I also get a chance to see inside his wardrobe to view his incredible clothing collection. Pete Burns was a leading light on the new romantic scene of the late 1980s with his group Dead or Alive. But a dissatisfaction with his appearance led him to experiment with plastic surgery. Over the next 20 years, he had numerous operations until a procedure to enlarge his lips went horribly wrong. Pete was injected with a chemical that poisoned his bloodstream and disfigured his face. What followed was a nightmare 18 months of major surgery to rebuild his looks. Only days after his final reconstructive surgery, Pete entered the Big Brother house. He'd been so ill, he hadn't worked for over 2 years.
I mean, the whole Big Brother time, during it, after it, so many people were probably confused about what was going on in your life at that time.
18 months of reconstructive surgery, huge doses of anaesthetic, two major surgeries a week to save my life, not just my face. I had my entire stomach wall removed to get tissue to harvest into my face. I had to be brought home by car because I couldn't fly, and then walking into the Big Brother house, and I was sleep deprived for over 3 weeks. And this sounds like an excuse, and it's not an excuse, it's what it was. And I came out and I couldn't go home, and I was physically ill with the surgery, and I ended up in a hotel, and the press were outside, and I was like not sleeping, and I needed some help, and I didn't want to let anyone down. And I checked into a psychiatric place to put me to sleep. And guess what? Every patient in the psychiatric ward had watched Big Brother, as well as the doctors. So I was no longer human. And they were asking for autographs. And I was like, this drug's killing me. I'm checking out.
It was on Big Brother that Pete caused public outrage when he said he was wearing a coat made of gorilla.
Pete's got a jacket made out of monkey.
My coat is in police custody.
Gorilla? Off.
My coat's been arrested.
And I want that coat back within the next 2 hours.
I am my fair coat.
It was immediately removed by the police for examination and found to be an antique monkey coat. Pete was innocent. All he'd done was buy vintage. But when he left the house, more controversy followed when he was sent to prison for threatening behaviour.
The police decided to have a bit of fun because I'd spoken out about the debacle with the fur coat and said, "What?" And I think somebody in a high place thought, hold on, he's making fun of us. And I think the police were actually out to get me. And they did get me.
What did that feel like, being thrown into prison after you'd been through so much already?
Yeah, but I'm a survivor. Everyone is potentially a survivor. It's just they give up far too easily. You know, a survivor can get tired, let them sleep, get back up and survive. But there's really no reason for anything to break anybody ever. That's a choice to let things break you.
Absolutely. I think a lot of people under those circumstances though would have crumbled. And I'm talking about the body trauma, not psychologically or mentally, because I met you at that time and I actually thought
I'm
that
a
you
German
were very
tank girl.
Yeah. I thought you were very resilient and your mind was actually very on the ball. But your body must have been going through some trauma. How many operations did you have?
There was two a week for 18 months. That's in a 5 day span of a week, two a week. So you do the maths, I'm not good with figures. And they were major operations. Major. And I was on morphine and pethidine, cancer-based painkillers, and that wouldn't kill the pain. I just made a decision one day, I'm not having this. And I just lit up a cigarette and got on with my life.
In the session, I get a strong sense that the spirit of Pete's mother is very close and wants to connect with him. Knowing his difficult past, I asked Pete to tell me more about what she was like to live with.
A discipline was so rigid. Make up on at 5 a.m, clean the house, look after me, change costume at 1 o'clock, clean the house again. The discipline, always to look good, and it didn't matter what you were feeling, look good feeling it.
But you're carrying that baton forward. I mean, to me, you're an extension
of
your mother.
I know no other way. That's the way. Why, if I feel depressed, why should I sit around looking like
Yeah, absolutely.
I'd rather sob with glamour.
But there's another woman, your grandmother is in the spirit world.
Who's my grandmother? My German
like,
grandmother?
No, it feels like your father's mother.
Oh, Nana, she hated me.
There's an absolute... Do you know
Agnes, she hated me.
The force of that woman is that, as we were talking about your mother...
But does she like me now?
The thing I sense, yeah, I do. Feel as though she's actually...
My dad doesn't.
...changing towards you. Because I feel as though she was a force in herself, a force to be reckoned with.
Nana, Agnes Burns, I know that she made my mum's initial time in England very difficult because it was England, German, and mother couldn't speak English. And my only real memory of my Nana is, yeah, she was lovely to me. She let me put on her daisy earrings. So she wasn't, in fact, yeah, and a high heel, so Nana was really cool. But always I remember the scars left on my mother that Nana... put there.
Do you know what? I actually feel as though there's a great feeling of resolve among those two. Because it's as if your mother's brought her to say, look, use her strength. Use your mother's creativity, or that's something you've got from your mother. But there's such a strong sense of this woman. And just this, almost so resilient, this woman.
A tough lady, yeah.
Real tough. But in the nicest sense, tough.
Actually, she used to buy me dolls and red Indian headdresses, and Nana was very good to me, but it's like when I was very young, she died. So then I have the memory of my mother being so angry with her, but then mother nursed her, so obviously there was some kind of peace that came into that. But you've just opened a realm for me because I forgot about how great...
Pete has been a fashion icon for over 20 years. It was his good looks and flamboyant style that propelled him to stardom. So I asked him to show me his incredible clothing collection.
Well, Gordon, here we are in Narnia.
Yeah, this is more than a wardrobe. Wow.
All of these clothes have led to various stages in my life, but this is not a stage wardrobe. This is the way I live. This is not me being Paris Stilton going, look at my wardrobe. This is my wardrobe. I get nothing for free. I get discounts on things because I'm a good clothes hanger. And they're very important to me. Clothes are walking art. We look at pictures on walls in galleries, and why go to a gallery when you can stick it on yourself and walk around? And clothes can have a magical effect on people or a very detrimental effect. That's the legendary Big Brother coat, which
is perfectly... And it was arrested, it's got a criminal record.
It's got a criminal record, just like me. But you know, it was a gift off Michael. He knew I liked furs, and he went to a vintage shop and he got me this fur, and I'm not sorry in the least. So
no.
That's all I can say about
that.
Because
hard, wasn't it?
I mean, come on, they're dead, and why should they just be burned? It's on a coat and it's very respected, and I wouldn't, you know, buy a brand new one. It's a vintage thing, so I'm not guilty. It's so boring.
Pete is now happily married to Michael Simpson, but the first love of his life was Lynn. They met as teenagers and were married for over 20 years. Together they would hang out on the club scene in Liverpool, and it wasn't long before Pete got noticed.
The Sex Pistols came to town and I met them, and the promoter of the club, Roger Eagle, came to me and he said, you have a great time in my club. I said, yes, you get a band, you're never coming in. I went, what? He went, unless you sing, you're never coming in. I was like, I can't sing. He said, you better learn to because you look so great. And then all the American punk wave are coming over. Cherry Vanilla, Wayne County, oh, so many of them, the Heartbreakers, and they kind of adopted me because of my image, and the next thing I got a band together with Julian Cope, and someone else did one gig, and it kind of went from there in the press, and but it was the clothes were always there, and I didn't feel, the clothes were just rapping for me, and the music was just a soundtrack for me, so I never considered myself a musician. It's just a way of making people aware that I am me, and ultimately I'm the thing that's for sale. Mm-hmm. I'm the shop front, and there's so many other things inside.
So this is your shoe collection?
I've always been able to walk in heels, and I think they give you a very good stature, and they make me very aware that I'm out, and I like clothes to be kind of uncomfortable, so I know I'm wearing them. And my shoe collection is, I think men's shoes are so ugly and downtrodden, and I grew up in the principle, if something's lovely, you can have it. Just because it's supposed to be for a lady doesn't mean you can have it. But this shoe collection here, the sculptural qualities of some of these actual things that Westwood did.
Oh, wow.
The platform is concealed, and they're just incredible things, and I can run, fight, and climb a drain pipe in those. I just love it, you know? These are like, just, these are the condom for my skin.
Yeah.
Me from the world.
Outer skins,
Yeah, and it's like, you know, I've got a huge wig collection.
Can I ask you something? And it's just something that popped into my mind and I've got to say it. Did your mother love wigs?
Absolutely.
Because I just, as you did that, I just had a picture of your mother
with
lots of wigs.
Yeah, but she used to have wig parties and I'd model them and pile them up together and she'd sell them. She was, and it's like, I totally got it. And she'd go, look at this, I can be any colour I want. And she'd throw it in the bin. And it's like, yeah, that's so true.
Disposable hair.
Yeah, it takes 2 minutes hair to go. And people say, is that your hair? Yeah, it is. Yeah. I bought it. I got every colour and every length and stuff like that, and some days I feel like I'm black-haired, and some days I feel like I'm blonde-haired, and other days I feel like I'm red-haired. I sleep in them as well, because it's... why shouldn't I?
Pete has always dressed flamboyantly, but refuses to be defined by how other people see him.
Some people have the perception, Pete, that you're transvestite or drag queen. What do you think of that?
Well, like, you know, really, I'm at the age where I really don't care what they think, but I know what they am, and I think everything is drag. Mm. The fact that somebody, a man, wakes up in the morning and shaves and they get the haircut and they get rid of the grey and they put the boots on and the jeans, that's drag.
Yeah.
Your drag is to face the world. It's your uniform, and this is my uniform. But it's nothing to... I mean, and, you know, hundreds and thousands of years ago, men were the ones that wore these things, and it's like now, it's not acceptable. You're supposed to be all macho and... It's just really sad that men are so trapped and in here. It's really sad. I see men, I think, you know what, you could have such fun.
Yeah.
And it's your friends and your girlfriend and they're all cramping your style and you're going to be on your deathbed and you're going to say, if only I'd worn a wig and some high heels. Just one.
Coming up, I find out how Pete nursed his mother through terminal cancer.
I opened the drawer and there was this photograph of her. Old lady, you know, yeah. Leaning out over the boat, looking onto the horizons, and I just thought, she's free now. She's gone home, so... But, I miss her.
We also visit his home village of Port Sunlight, the place that Pete grew up in and swore he'd never return to. Pete Burns is an extrovert character, yet having spent time with him, I can see that there is much more to him than we see in public. Pete grew up in an isolated village before breaking into the music business and eventually moving to London's Notting Hill.
I felt that Pete was warming to me, so I asked him to take me to the house he once owned in Notting Hill where his mother Eva died.
I like to think Mum's in there, but now I don't think she is. I think she's in my house.
I think she can be.
I want her to be in my house. She'd love it.
I think she's in your house too.
Well, on my journey, you know, my mum, I was really famous.
This was the famous Spin, yeah.
After Spin, I was breaking in America, and on this particular day, I booked a photo shoot for my mum for Sunday magazine, and she arrived, and I walked into my other home, 7 Holland Park Avenue, and my dad was po-faced, and I knew. He said, your mum's got lung cancer, I just knew, and I thought, fuck. And then my manager at the time phoned up and said, you're on the Madonna tour. And I said, you didn't tell me about this. He said, no, we've done the merchandise deal, the record company said to go. And I said, Chris, my mum's got lung cancer, I'm not going on a Madonna tour. And he said to me, you'll go on that Madonna tour. I went, Chris, my mum's got lung cancer, and that's it, bang. And my mum was in shock, and I was like, what am I going to do? I wet the bed, actually.
God.
And the next morning, my answer machine went off, and I heard this voice say, if you don't want your career to crawl around screaming, as your mother's going to do when she's in a hospice and be buried rotten of cancer, you'll do that tour. My mum heard it, and I thought, right, Mr. Manager, bye. Change the phone number.
Absolutely horrible.
And I literally did run the streets. We were in the other flat for weeks, and she was sleeping on a camp bed. She never went home. How young is that? And I ran around the street for weeks with Lynn, and we walked down this street, because it was cheaper than Holland Park at the time. And I saw this place, and I went, that's where she's going to be.
Pete put his career on hold for 11 months to nurse his mother through terminal lung cancer.
Do you know what I see when you're talking to me and talking about your mother at this time? I see her looking fantastic, makeup on, and I actually see her almost as though you're standing behind her and she's sitting down, almost as though there's a photograph taken. Or
I came to London, when the day she was diagnosed, she came to London, I had a photo shoot with her the next day, and everyone was crying, and it's in all the Sunday, it's on the internet, there's a photo of me like this and mum, and I'm crying, and she's looking right into the camera, and inside the magazine's face of my dad and me and Lynn, and they're crying, you can tell, and I've been crying too, and she's looking right into the camera with the diamonds.
Professional.
Right into the camera.
Yeah.
Good mum.
There's some memory of that that I feel.
To do a photo shoot and you're told you've got six weeks to live, and you got terminal lung cancer, and then to turn up at a photo shoot, and she just looked great. Everyone was upset because they knew, and hushed whispers, and she was like, will you stop f***ing whispering? Yeah. You know, and to me, that's the only way.
It's commendable.
And I kept thinking, I shouldn't be like this. I shouldn't be like the way she is. And it was like, I am that way. And it was like, come on, we'll do this.
Yeah.
I had to go and do these dates, I think, in America. I didn't want to. She said, don't worry, I'll be here when you get back. It's like, okay, Mum, it's 2 weeks, and the tour of America was great, and I had a huge production. And I got to New York, the last show, and I thought, Mum's gone. And I was in the Westbury Hotel, and I got a phone call, she's gone. And I went, oh my God, no, it's okay, she's gone now, it's all right, I'll do the show. And everyone's in the industry, they thought, you heartless bastard, you did a show on the day your mum died, but I wasn't gonna fly back, and, you know, she's gone, and that's fine, but I did the show, and I went to Ohio for a break, and I didn't go to the funeral, because I didn't want to see it. A lot of my friends, gay friends, went to the funeral because all the gay friends they idolised my mother. Yeah. Now I came back here to clear her stuff out, and it was New Year's Eve, and I was in there, and this tremendous knocking ripped round the wall, and I was with Steve Coy, my drummer and ex-manager, and the knocking was so aggressive. Actually, the knocking started in New York on the afternoon she died, and the pictures fell off the wall.
Wow.
I forget all this, but it's, you know, your crystal balls that are
opening
yeah,
up
your crystal balls are opening me and ectoplasm's about to spray. And the knocking started at the Westbury, and I went, that's Mum, and I went in there, and the knocking was so violent, went like a circle around the building, and I said, that's Mum, and then I opened the drawer, and there was this photograph of her, old lady, you know, leaning out over a boat, looking onto the horizons, and I just thought, she's free now, she's gone home, so, but I miss her.
After meeting Pete in London,
Events took a turn for the worse, and Pete went into a deep depression. It was 3 months before I was able to meet him again. I had a strong sense there was so much more to the story of his relationship with his mother than he was able to tell me. With this in mind, I suggest we go back to where he grew up, hoping that this would stimulate memories of his childhood.
Pete was born in Port Sunlight near Liverpool, a seemingly idyllic village specially built by Lever Brothers to house its factory staff, and where Pete's father, Francis Burns, worked. Pete agreed to meet me nearby. It was the first time in years that he'd been back there.
The funny thing for me, even coming up to this place, to Port Sunlight, and just coming through this place, even before I saw you here, I was picking up these visual images, like photographs in my mind.
What were they?
To me, it was your mum. I felt as though it was your mum, but as a very, very young woman. Not as how she would have been the last time we did the reading, not somebody who came through when she had been ill and yeah. things like that. I was seeing the almost like black and white stills of the woman. Mm. That's what it was like to see all this collection of black and white stills. And I saw, funnily enough, a really, really fantastic fur coat.
But yeah, she liked her
furs. But there was something amazing about this one. It wasn't just an ordinary fur. See how women had fox heads and things? Mm. But there was heads or there was animals. And it was really, really grand, but she was very young. And the funny feeling I got was she was two people. This is what she was trying to make me aware of. It's as though she's in the other side, if you like, going through some kind of change and trying to reconcile a lot of the stuff from her past.
Yeah.
This is the feeling I get. And it's like coming through this place was almost like to her. It was like coming down from that life.
More or less from very early childhood, I was very aware how unhappy she was here.
She's got this aloofness as a younger woman
and
a brightness.
She was an aristocrat. You know, she was a German aristocrat, so she obviously was aloof. And to come somewhere like Port Sunlight, to her, was a living death. She'd done it to escape the war. Mm. And she'd ended up here with a son, which is my older brother. Yeah. He's 11 years older than me. And she felt imprisoned here in Port Sunlight. And my memories, I don't think I've got really one good memory of Port Sunlight. All I remember as a child is sensing her pain and her feeling that she was in a living death here.
So what was it like growing up as a little boy in that house?
It was just incredibly lonely, and I had a red Indian headdress and a wigwam. It's documented in a photograph, and I lived in the wigwam. But now, you know, in all honesty, mm-hmm. I lived in the wigwam because I didn't want to come out of the wigwam into what was
Absolutely.
Going on in my house. Yeah, I can always remember, it must have been 4 a.m, being carried down the stairs in the house, and literal bedlam. Mm-hmm. going on while she set up lights and mirrors and stuff like that. And she would do the most amazingly flawless makeup, mm-hmm. and it would take her a couple of hours, and she'd still do all the housework. She didn't just do that, she did all the house. This is before alcoholism set in, this is very early on. But having to watch her do these things and everything, it was a learning curve, it was an experience, and it was a discipline that she, you know, she absolutely maintained. But I still think there's something a bit odd about getting your child up at 4 a.m. and making him, you know, sit there while you put on your makeup.
Totally. The sense I get at the moment is of this turnaround that she's trying to get through to you. And she's talking about somebody called Mary or Maria who's with her. I've met Mary or Maria who's in the spirit world with her. I feel this person standing beside her. There's another woman there. Not an old woman, I feel a woman, I don't know, maybe in her 50s or something like this. But I get the sense of this woman standing with her. As though the two of them are...
Her mother's name was Maria.
And she'll be in the spirit world then, obviously, but this sense is that the two women are standing together as though they're trying to sort things out in their life. Because a lot of what your mother did in her young life, I get the feeling it was on the run. It had to just be done. Just get up and do things. And it's almost like she's trying to say to you that a lot of the things that have been happening to you have just been on the run. You have to think on your feet, very much like she did, because I feel as though there's still a close connection. But I do sense that it's as if she's trying to point out to you that, you know, you're coming to a point in your life where I feel as though, don't be frightened of the next 5-6 months. And I'll tell you why. It's going to actually be a lot happier or a lot more uplifting than you know. I just get this lovely sense of, it's like a cloud you feel hanging over you, and it's as though she's saying, that cloud will not happen. It's not going to happen. Because there's something really...
She's still very much active in my life.